We don't have sex with each other in our van. Thank God. We don't even have food with each other. I took her to a supermarket. I don't know why, but I had to start it somewhere. So it started there. I said, pretend you got no money. And she just laughed and said, oh, you're so funny. I said, yeah. I can't see anyone else smiling. Are you sure? You wanna live like common people. You wanna see whatever common people see. Wanna sleep with common people. You wanna sleep with common people like me. But she didn't understand. And she just smiled and held my hand. I went to flat trip over the shop. Cut your hair and get a job. I was at school, I suppose I was what was considered a nerd. I mean, I was like, you know, specky and tall and thin with bad teeth and that. And so, you know, I wasn't a fanny magnet by any stretch of the imagination. And so, revenge of Supernerd, as the Daily Star put it, well, I suppose, I mean, I am considered to be presentable now, I suppose. So that's good, that's a triumph for me. When I go back to Sheffield, I still get abuse. Because this is a thing that, like, sometimes people think that you dress in a certain way or for a laugh. But in Sheffield, it was a bit more grim than that because people will actually smack you and beat you up if they think that you look funny. And so wearing certain clothes isn't a joke in Sheffield. You're taking your life in your hands. So. And it still happens to me when I go back, because I went back to Sheffield for Christmas recently, and it all comes back to you. You kind of forget, because you can get away with anything in London, but once you get back there, you know, you get off the train, and then you're dodging and trying not to get beaten up before you get home, kind of thing. Well, that was all right for a while, but soon I wanted more. I want to see as well as hear, and so I hid inside her wardrobe, and she came home round four, and she was with some kid called David, and from the garage up the road. I listened outside, I heard her. Well, people say the camera doesn't lie or whatever, but the thing is, the camera does focus your attention on certain things, like it's daft to say that if you had you got a camera in this room and you film something, that you're just seeing the room, because the camera will, if a camera like points at that picture on the wall over there or something, then your attention's drawn to it. Just being in a room, your attention isn't particularly drawn to that picture, but once the camera's pointing at it, you think, oh, that must be significant in some way, I'll look at that. And I think it's the same, a little bit the same in songs, that you'll describe things within a situation, like a hole in the carpet or something like that, and by describing them, you give them some significance, and it says something about the way this person's living or about their state of mind or something. I think that details are the things that reveal things. I mean, obviously, you don't want to make the same record again, because that would be boring, wouldn't it? But then again, you know, you've got certain, the things that you're bothered about in your life don't change that much throughout your life. You know, like, I mean, people say that record's a lot about sex, you know, which it is. But, you know, I am interested in it, it's not that I've got a one-track mind, but I mean, I'm not going to go off it and suddenly get into gardening. It's that thing of constantly looking for a new angle on things, I suppose. That's why, you know, the important things in life have always been the same, I guess, the motivating things. And amongst them, I think sex is a really big motivating factor in people's lives. A lot of things, the reason behind it is sexually motivated. But that doesn't mean that everybody should give up writing songs or writing books, because the subject matter is always the same. I think you just have to try and look for a different angle on it somehow and make it interesting again. I've never been very good at chatting up. That was one of the motivating things behind joining the band. I thought, well, if I can get to be semi-famous, then people will come and talk to me rather than me having to go and talk to them. Not just for chatting up purposes, but just for general having friends, you know. I mean, sometimes you get people coming up and talking to you you'd rather not have talking to you. And I don't know whether it is such a good idea, really, because maybe you ought to be more active in choosing your friends rather than having them choose you. But it has worked in that respect, yeah. Then you can decide whether you like them or not, and if you think they're a nightmare, then you just say, oh, God, I've got a terrible bowel problem, I've got to run off the toilet or whatever, yeah. Fell asleep inside, I never heard her come. Oh, I had opened up the wardrobe, and I had to get it on, yeah. Oh, listen, oh, we were on the bed when you came home. I heard you stop outside the door. Sometimes you think, don't you? You think, oh God, I'm getting a bit decrepit. I wish I was young again. But then I remember, it was quite recently, I went past, like, there was a queue outside one of them under-18s discos, and there was all that kind of nudging and, go on, talk to her, talk to her, she fancies you, my mate fancies you, and all that kind of stuff. They just used to be so, oh God, you know, used to get really wound up, and I wouldn't want to go back to being like that. That's the thing, you see, that's the scary thing, isn't it? That you don't know whether you've changed, because if the way your mind works and the way you see things has changed, you become blind to it because you only perceive things through your own mind, don't you?
Right.
Yeah. My father.
Your father?
Because I've met him in my life, but about 24 years ago was the last time. So obviously we weren't on much of an equal footing.
Yeah.
But he ran off to Australia to escape maintenance payments. And has stayed there ever since. He is an actor, actually. He was in, I don't know if you ever remember, there was a cricketing programme called Bodyline.
Yeah,
you remember that?
Bradman or something?
Yeah, it was all about, he was in that, just a small role. Man in Bar, I think, was his role. What would I say to him? I'd say, where's that pocket money you owe me? I've never wanted to be alternative. I'd like to be, on a scale of 1 to 50, I'd prefer to be naught. think that's a trick with life, really, knowing when to stop. Or knowing when to move on from one thing to another.
And knowing when to start.
And knowing when to start, yeah. I guess.